Today on Answers with Bayless Conley.
God is telling us, hey, I want to use you to reach the harvest fields of the world, to bring precious souls into the kingdom, but you cannot do it in your own strength and with your own wisdom. You need Holy Spirit power. You need miracle working power. You need empowerment from on high if you're going to be effective in bringing in the harvest. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you. He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley, and I want to welcome you. I have a message that I preach to our church called The Fire, The Frequency, and The Focus of the Church. It was something I felt so strongly that the Holy Spirit had given to me. And if no other reason, you just need to listen to it because it's got a really cool title. Now, I honestly believe there's some things in here that are going to bless you, that are going to help you. So get ready, put on your seatbelt, put on your crash helmet. Let's get into the Word together. I want to begin by telling you, my goal today is to get your hopes up. I want to encourage you to expect the supernatural help of the Holy Spirit as you give your life in service to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm going to do all I can to get your hopes up, to help you be expectant. You know, we look in the book of Acts and through the epistles, and we see the early church born of the Spirit, baptized in the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit, guided by the Spirit, and comforted by the Spirit, and we should expect no less. Amen. Now, the Apostle Paul, writing to the Galatian church, asks a very penetrating question. Galatians 3:3, he asks, are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit, are you now being made perfect by the flesh? Having begun your Christian life, you know, born of the Spirit, aided by the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit, guided by the Spirit, comforted by the Spirit, are you now going to finish this thing in your own power? What a question. Another translation says, you began your life in Christ with the Spirit. Now do you try to complete it by your own power? That is foolish. And as it pertains to the church, us as a local church, the body of church, you know, the body of Christ, the church universal. Have we replaced heavenly wisdom and heavenly strength with earthly philosophies and human strength? In the church, are we carrying on day by day in the power of the flesh with our own wisdom, with our own strength? Or are we looking to the Holy Spirit to guide us and empower us, and comfort us, and do all of the things that we read in the scriptures? And I want to talk to you today about three truths from the early church. Acts chapter 1, we're going to begin there. A church on fire. Acts 1 and verse 4, speaking about Jesus and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Verse 8, but you shall receive power. Everyone say power. Power. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. So he said, look, don't leave Jerusalem. Don't go out and evangelize. Don't try and do anything. You wait for the promise of the Father. You're going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will receive power. It's the word translated healing power or miracle throughout the New Testament. You're going to receive a miracle working power. And we come to chapter 2. Verse 1, there's 120 disciples gathered in the upper room. Even Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there. and they're praying, and this is what happens. Verse 1, this is the event. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, it's interesting that this happened at the Feast of Pentecost. There's actually three main feasts that Israel had, three pilgrimage feasts, if you would, where all of the men had to come to Jerusalem, you know, for these feasts. The first one was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, or the Passover. And that, of course, represents our salvation. They celebrated the time when they were in bondage, and they killed the lambs and put the blood over their doorposts, and God brought them out of Egyptian bondage, typical of us being released from the bondage of sin. So that first festival points to our salvation. The second one was the Feast of Weeks, or the Feast of Pentecost. And that took place 50 days after the Passover. And it literally was a celebration of the harvest. It began, the scripture says it's to begin when you first put the sickle into the harvest. And it deals with us being used by God now to harvest the souls around the world, a harvest of humanity. And it's interesting, it happened on Pentecost. That's just the Greek word meaning 50. It was 50 days. You would count 7 weeks in a day, and that was the day they celebrated. That's all Pentecost means. And the fact that the Holy Spirit and power came on that day, God is telling us, hey, I want to use you to reach the harvest fields of the world, to bring precious souls into the kingdom, but you cannot do it in your own strength and with your own wisdom. You need Holy Spirit power. You need miracle working power. You need empowerment from on high if you're going to be effective in bringing in the harvest. And then the third great festival was the Feast of Tabernacles, or the Feast of Booths. And they would come into Jerusalem and they would set up little booths or just temporary shelters, and they would live in those for a week. They wouldn't go into their homes. They would live in these little shelters. And God said, that's so you remember that when I brought you out of the land of Egypt, you were sojourners as you were going to the promised land. And for us, it points to the fact that we're just passing through, my friend. We are pilgrims and sojourners, the scripture says. We're only here for a little time. Our life is a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. And we do not have forever to do the Lord's work. My friend, everything you're accumulating right now in your life, you're going to leave every bit of it behind. And there's no telling what the next generation is going to do with that. Amen. You're just here for a little while. Amen. And then you will stand before God, and I will stand before God. And so Jesus says, hey, you wait for the promise of the Father. You're going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit, and when he comes upon you, you'll receive power. And it's interesting. When the Holy Spirit came like a rushing mighty wind. Why the wind? I don't know. I suppose it's symbolic. I'll tell you a little story, and I don't know that I've ever shared this in church before. But I was doing a Bible study right in this area in Los Alamitos. This has to be 40-something years ago. And the house was packed with people. We had a bunch of Baptists that came in, and we're praying for people, and they're getting filled with the Holy Spirit. And I was teaching on the Holy Spirit that night. Several people had been filled with the Holy Spirit. Every door was shut. Every window was shut in the house. And I remember there was this guy sitting next to me. He's a high school senior and kind of a, you know, a tough guy. And in fact, he later went on to become the lead singer of a very famous band, Coast to Coast. There's some of you in here would definitely know who he is. And he's sitting next to me on the fireplace. I'm sitting in a chair, and all of a sudden, a wind went through the room. There wasn't an open door, there wasn't an open window, and the curtains went whoosh. And I looked at him, his eyes were like saucers. He had a glass of water, and he's going like this. And the water's jumping out of the glass. He puts it down, walks across the room, down the hallway, and goes in the bathroom. Shuts the door. He comes out 10 minutes later speaking in other tongues. That happened. Why? Why was there a wind? I don't know. Why was there a wind on Pentecost? I don't know. But there was also divided tongues of fire that sat upon each of them. And I believe that's symbolic as well. And I think I know why that symbolism took place. Under the old covenant, when God led his people from Egypt into the promised land, at night there was a pillar of fire. It was a manifestation of the Holy Spirit. And that pillar of fire gave them light. It gave them heat. But when the pillar of fire would move, they would break camp and they would follow that pillar of fire. God led them outwardly, supernaturally. And now the Holy Spirit is not going to lead us outwardly. He comes upon each one of them individually. Jesus said, the Holy Spirit is with you, but he will be in you. He used to lead them corporately, outwardly, and now he will lead every member of the body of Christ inwardly because he dwells in us. And so they're filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak with other tongues. That meeting breaks out down on the street. There's a revival. 3,000 people get saved. And we read through the book of Acts, Acts chapter 10, 10 years after Acts chapter 2, 10 years after this event on the day of Pentecost. Peter's in the household of Cornelius. The Holy Spirit falls. Everyone in the house is filled with the Holy Spirit, and they begin to speak with other tongues. We move forward, Acts chapter 19, 20 years after Acts chapter 2, 20 years after this event on the day of Pentecost. Paul's in Ephesus, runs into some disciples. He asks them, have you heard of the Holy Spirit since you believe? Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believe? They said, we haven't even heard whether there's a Holy Spirit. Paul says, what do you believe in? They said, well, you know, John's baptism. John told us the Messiah was coming, and we put our trust in that. We know he's coming. Paul said, look, he's not coming. He already came. His name is Jesus. And they got baptized in the name of Jesus. They put their trust in him. Now they're saved. And then Paul laid hands upon them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues and prophesy. 20 years after the event that we just read there, and Jesus said, when that happens, you will receive power, miracle-working power. It's the same power that went out of Jesus and healed the woman with the issue of blood, identical Greek word. When the scripture says virtue flowed out of Jesus and healed the multitude, it's the same word we read in Acts 1 and 8. Stephen, who was a table waiter, the Bible says he was full of faith and power, same Greek word. He did great wonders and miracles among the people. My friend, that power is available today. You know, Pastor Harrison that's here, he was healed of deafness when he was a little boy, same power. One of my dearest friends came into Cottonwood Church back when we were at Sausalito, at the campus there, screwed up his life royally. He was an alcoholic, had basically crashed and burned his marriage, separated from his wife, didn't look like there's any hope there, and he's permanently disabled due to a serious back injury. He walks in the church. First day he came in, he was drunk. I wasn't even the one to pray for him. Somebody else prayed for him. He got set free from years of alcoholism. God healed his back, and in a short process of time, restored his marriage. What did that? Power. You receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, Jesus said. Now, the same Holy Spirit that works miracles will also empower our speech. You know, in Acts chapter 7, Stephen, the Bible says he was full of faith and power, same word, and he did great signs and wonders among the people. And then the second thing it says is the Spirit empowered his speech. It says they couldn't resist the wisdom and the Spirit by which he spoke. I still remember the day in Lithia Park in Ashland, Oregon. I had almost died the night before due to excessive drug use. I was extremely depressed. Sitting by myself by the creek, hidden from view, and a little 12-year-old boy slid down the opposite creek bank. He looked at me, and he spoke 7 words that changed my life. He said, do you know Jesus? Isn't he wonderful? That was the turning point for my life. Those words slammed into me and anchored themselves in my heart. And because a 12-year-old boy talked to me about Jesus, I ended up in a street mission sometime later where I got saved. My friend, the Holy Spirit power comes upon you when you're baptized in the Spirit, and he wants to empower your speech, wants you to anoint you. He wants to anoint you as you pray for the sick, and we need to respect it. The second thing that early church was, it was a church on the right frequency. You know, the human ear can only hear within a certain frequency range. Dolphins and bats, they can hear things at a much higher frequency than we can hear. We don't hear any sound at all. They hear distinctly. The point, just because you're not hearing anything doesn't mean that there is no sound to be heard. The Holy Spirit speaks on a certain frequency, and it cannot be discerned except by your spirit. You are a spirit being, you have a soul, you live in a physical body. And the Holy Spirit, when he speaks, doesn't speak to your intellect, doesn't speak to your feelings. Those are the wrong frequencies. Now, it may affect your feelings eventually, and things may dawn on you intellectually eventually. But the Holy Spirit, when he speaks to your spirit. Romans 8 and 16 says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. The Holy Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit. He doesn't bear witness with our feelings. Doesn't bear witness with our mind. He bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will guide you into all truth, and he will show you things to come. And he does that through our spirits. And the best way that I know to become sensitive to and familiar with your own spirit is to pray in other tongues. That's the best way I know. 1 Corinthians 14 and 14, the Apostle Paul said, for when I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prays. My mind is unfruitful. One translation says, my mind draws a blank. But when I pray in an unknown tongue, I'm speaking mysteries to God, the Bible says. I'm edifying myself, charging myself literally with energy. But it says, when I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prays. The Amplified Bible says, when I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit by the Holy Spirit within me prays. Listen, the same place that other tongues originates, that is the place the Holy Spirit speaks to you. That is the same place the Holy Spirit bears witness.
Yes, it is.
And I need to hear from God. I'll just pray in other tongues for 45 minutes or an hour. And then just get quiet.
Amen.
Become very sensitive to your spirit. We make so much noise mentally. Many of us, we live on the frequency of feelings. We live on the frequency of our intellect. And we're feeding those things all the time. And our life is all about that. And some people are very out of touch with their own heart. Some people are very out of touch with their own spirit.
Come on.
That is the best way that I know to become sensitive to where the Holy Spirit will speak to you. The Holy Spirit wants to guide us. We should expect that individually, but we should also pray for it to happen corporately. That God would lead the church. You can read in Acts 15 and verse 28. Very serious matter. And so James, who's the pastor of the church in Jerusalem, and the leadership team gets together and they pray about it. What direction are we going to go? What does God want us to do? Because it's going to affect the church for generations to come. And when they came out of that meeting, you read it, Acts 15, 28, this is what they said. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to do thus and so. And they had a game plan. Think of that language. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us. How did the Holy Spirit make his will known? We're not told. Was it a prophecy? I don't know. Did they all just have an inward witness? I don't know. Did somebody get it? I don't know. Did somebody get a vision? I don't know. But the Holy Spirit guided them as a church. And then finally, this early church was a church in focus. You know, I haven't kept up with the latest breakthroughs in LASIK surgery. But you know, these eye surgeries they would do, and I've quite a few people in my personal world that have had it done. They would do one eye so that it can see far off and one eye so that it can see close. And apparently your brain adjusts. So when you read, you know, your close-up eye takes over, and when you're trying to read a freeway sign at night, your other eye, you know, takes over there. And the brain is just an amazing thing. And so it adjusts to that so that you don't even have to think about it. Well, I think as a church, we need to have that kind of focus. Close up, far away. Close up focus, we need to look at the harvest fields that are right before us. We need to win souls and then teach them and help them grow and become disciples. Because friend, everyone you know will spend eternity somewhere. And God is not willing that any perish, but all come to repentance and to the knowledge of the truth. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost, even those that are staunchly opposed to you politically. Jesus died for them. Oswald Chambers said, the church that doesn't evangelize will fossilize. We must lift our eyes and look at the harvest fields. As you read through the book of Acts from beginning to end, the gospel is being preached and souls are being won. It is the most important thing on God's agenda. And we need to have that in focus. Corporately as a church, but individually as well. I mean, where you work, what about those people? Person that sits on the desk to your right or your left, they're going to spend eternity somewhere. They will. The people that you have lunch with in the lunchroom, people you interact with day by day, the people I interact with. As a church, yes, we need to support missions and be involved in taking the gospel around the world. We're doing all we can corporately. But individually, we must be focused that way, and we must learn to think that way as well. And God will use you, my friend. We already said it. He will empower your speech. He'll help you, and it doesn't have to be something eloquent. It can be something as simple as, do you know Jesus? Isn't he wonderful? Seven words can change a person's life, my friend. And I think that one thing that helps us when it comes to that is the long-range focus. We need to be using both eyes. Have one eye focused on the judgment seat of Christ and eternity. Psalm 39 and 5 says, certainly every man at his best state is vapor. Psalm 62 and 9 says, men of low degree and men of high degree are altogether lighter than vapor. James 4 and 14, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time, a little while, and then vanishes away. We're only here for a little while. We don't have long to work. And then comes eternity. And seeing that our time here is so short and the most important thing to God are souls, shouldn't we be inspired to speak and to pray and to give for the cause of Christ? Even if it brings persecution our way. And I really felt like I was supposed to talk to you about this. You know, we read in Acts 1:8, you know, Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you receive power, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. Now, he didn't say Jerusalem, and then when you finish there, Judea, and when you're finished there, Samaria, and when you're done there, then you can go to the rest of the earth. He said Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth. We need to work all those harvest fields simultaneously. But he said, you'll be my witnesses in all the earth. Power will come upon you. Now that word witness, it means to speak on behalf of, to speak up for, to give your witness for Christ. But it's also the same Greek word translated martyr. It means that you're willing to give your witness and to not deny your faith, even if it were to cost you your life. In Acts 22, it speaks of Stephen. He was the church's first martyr, uses the word martyr. He was killed for his faith. It's the same word in Acts 1:8 for witness. In Revelation chapter 2, Jesus speaks of those that won't deny their faith and they won't compromise their position on the truth. And the Lord speaks specifically of his faithful martyr, Antipas, who, because he wouldn't compromise, because he wouldn't back up, it cost him his life. He was willing to witness, even though the cost was ultimate. And I wonder, how will we stack up against those who refuse to compromise or deny, even in the face of death, if we shrink back because it may cost us popularity or position among our peers? How will we stack up against people like that? But we have brothers and sisters around the world that cannot get a job. They're persecuted severely. In some cases, lose their lives if they will not recant regarding their faith in Christ. The Holy Spirit, when he comes upon us, he gives power to be a witness. He'll give us power to live right, and if need be, he'll give us power to die right. Revelation 12, 11 says this: they overcame him because the Lamb gave his life's blood for them. They overcame him by giving witness about Jesus to others. They were willing to risk their lives, even if it led to death. That is the mindset that the Holy Spirit wants to work in every one of us as we look to him and as we yield ourselves to him. God wants us to be a church on fire. He wants us to be a church listening to the right frequency. And he wants us to be in church, a church in focus. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ and you've gotten lukewarm, I pray that you would catch fire once again, that you'd be excited about the things of God, that you would be concerned about those in your community and your family that are living without Christ, and that you would do something about it, beginning with prayer and then sharing something with someone, sharing the gospel with someone in need. And if you don't know Jesus, I pray you'd open your heart to him right now. Ask him to come into your life. He will come in. He will change you. He will save you. He will wash you clean. And I want to say, as I do just about every time, thank you, a big thank you to those that support us with prayer and with finances and help us to take these messages around the world. There is great fruit accruing to your account in heaven because of your generosity. May God bless you richly. We'll see you again.
Over the last 30 years, through Answers with Bayless Conley, thousands of lives have been transformed around the world. Every day through our broadcast, we are reaching people with the urgent message of the gospel. This year, because of the support of our generous partners, we've been able to share the practical answers that come from God's Word to people who may have never heard it before. We have received testimonies from people that move from fear to faith and from despair to hope. And right now, thousands of people like you are finding answers from the Word of God at a time when they need it most. It's because of the generous people like you who give at BaylessConley.com that we are able to continue. Everyone faces circumstances where they need the answers only God can provide. And right now, our television outreach is how many people around the world hear the message of Jesus. When you give today, you become part of the team, bringing people the hope that can only be found through Jesus. Whether it's through our broadcast, our online presence, or our products and devotionals, your gift enables us to put vital, timely materials in the hands of those who need it most. When you go online to BaylessConley.com, you can make a difference, both now and for eternity. Your support enables us to continue to broadcast, to continue to produce materials, and to continue to be a voice of hope. Please make a monthly or one-time gift right now at BaylessConley.com. Your donation says you care about others having access to the gospel. Please go online now to BaylessConley.com to give.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.